balance in there, what people pick when they introduce others. So, thank you. This was really generous. Thank you to the RCC for having me. Thank you for coming. So, when you think about the environmental history of Eastern Europe and the Soviet period, what comes to your mind? Don't worry, I'm going to answer this question. Collective farming, hyper-industrialized projects like the Biromor Canal, the space and arms race, maybe Chelyabinsk, but it wasn't very well described still. But definitely the Chernobyl disaster. And plenty of books have been written and studies conducted, usually by Anglo-American historians, on the anti-environmental history of Soviet countries. But how to measure the difference between the capitalist West and communist East in damaging nature and increasing ecological risk during the Cold War, since the opposition between East and West is very often constructed as normative, leading to the stigmatization of Soviet Eastern Europe. And I would like to show you just a few examples of such books that had tremendous impact on bringing this dominant discourse. On the other hand, the list of environmental catastrophes in the former Soviet Union, which influenced both other Soviet bloc countries in Eastern Europe and nations in Western Europe, is really long. And it is almost impossible to present them without severe criticism of Soviet leaders and their utopian anti-environmental vision of nature as a mere resource and their related politics of aggression against the non-human world. However, there have been attempts, including by leading environmental historians of the Soviet Union, such as Douglas Weiner and Paul Josephson, to present past events outside of this discourse of stigmatization. In this talk, I would like to ask what kind of source literature for historical recollection is, and where it may influence the writing workshop of a historian. I would like to claim that literature is not an alternative to history, but it can get us closer to historical events, make us more critical to the language we use, and reflective, make us more reflective on how we narrate the past. The case of environmental history is particularly interesting because literature can fill some gaps in representing non-human actors, where the historical discourse cracks or limits itself, or maybe is not enough to commemorate. Let me warm you up with two absolutely powerful examples. And first is a poem written by a Russian writer, Andrei Voznesensky, about the dogs who were the first living creatures to survive a test in space to orbit the Earth. And I'm going to read this poem. However, it's always a challenge to change the style of language. Hey Russia, you are all in the dark. There is a doggy smell up in the sky. Over topsails, power stations, masts, antenna and factory chimneys, the corpse of a dog rushes through the atmosphere in the terrifying sputnik of progress. And there is another poem that I really love, is about the dog that hasn't got so much luck and did not survive the first space test. It was Wajka, who died in 1957, and to whom a Polish poet, Zbigniew Herbert, dedicated his poem. And I'm reading just the first two stanzas. So first, the faithful dog, and after it, a pig or us. Through the black grass will beat a track, along it will the first man steal, who with iron hand will smother on his glass, brow a drop of fear. So first the dog, honest mongrel, which has never abandoned us, dreaming of earthy lumps and bones, will fall asleep in its whirling kennel, its warm blood boiling, drying away. Aesthetics, imagination, and experience are part of what I call environmental historiography. And we might want to contextualize the past of Eastern European countries not only in the framework of the historical study of the Soviet anti-ecological era, but also within cultural memory, and as they are reflected in literary sources. Memory, in a way, is more flexible and dynamic than historical discourse. Memory can encroach on the historical narrative and remind us of what was lost or forgotten, brings the idea of what we can do with literary texts for extending the memory over environments and non-humans. So what interests me, in other words, is arranging and rearranging memory of human relations with the environment through literature that shows nature as an essential part of the communist project. Therefore, I will absolutely compendiously, and sorry for that, look at some other literary examples in reference to the history of Soviet collectivization and also hyper-industrialization. I wanted, in fact, to refer to some texts connected with Chernobyl catastrophism, which is a huge topic now, but I had to, you know, limit myself. At the same time, I have to emphasize that I do not essentialize the Soviet Eastern Europe, and in order, let's say, not to close off the Soviet aspect from the world's and territory, but instead to demonstrate the elements of a larger narrative. How the late stage of heavy modernity, understood as a critical period which preceded and prepared what is called now the Anthropocene, operates. So I'm going to concentrate on three examples regarding the environmental history of collectivization, and starting with the examples in reference to the peasantry in Russia, which represented the overwhelming majority of the population and was the main victim of Stalin's actions. The experience of peasants of state intervention, collectivization, resulted in changes to the culturally independent village. Its relationship with the environment and the whole discourse of peasantry and its culture being linked with nature and society, as expressed in folk traditions and the highly religious character of the community. The development of collectivized agriculture brought not only new machinery to be used, but also fertilizers, erosion, and soil pollution. And you probably, you know all of these, but in Ukraine, for example, the environmental damage was accompanied by human and animal losses on a totally mega, you know, scale because of Purchase and the Great Famine of 1932-1933, the Holodomor, which is also now the topic, such, you know, compare it even to the Holocaust, how it is now discussed. While the collectivization projected by Stalin was never accomplished, it caused the greatest damage to human nature communities, as well as other projects of the first five-year plan, called the Great Rupture by historians, something like the Great Acceleration in the Stalin era. And this period is in a powerful way addressed by literary texts, such as the first one is The Foundation Pit, from published very late, but written during this first stage of high Stalinism and collectivization. So The Foundation Pit by Russian writer Andrei Platonov is one of the bitterest images of proletarian labor and the kolkhoz. Platonov originally incorporated the Stalinist propaganda narrative, reversing it, in fact, in the two intertwining sceneries of the construction site and the collectivized village, formerly divided, now to be connected. And although the Soviet style rural economy had its regional state variations, the complete collectivization of Ukrainian or Czechoslovakian farming versus the predominance of family farming in Poland, apart from Peggy Ery, which may translate into different environmental consequences and, as a result, different cultural responses to this period, the example of Platonov can probably be regarded as the first such expressive text to emerge during this first and most exploitative wave of collectivization for people and the natural environment. This is also the first anti-Soviet testimony that shows not only the vulnerability of the people, but also of nature and land. And I can just show you some samples, some fragments, which is always painful for the literary scholar. So the first fragment, that you can have the taste of the language, of how the propaganda language is merged with the very, very tragic story. The residual non-collectivized horses slept sadly in their stalls, tethered so firmly in order that they should never fall, since some horses already stood dead on their feet. In anticipation of the collective farm, the less impecunious peasants had kept their horses without nourishment, so that they would enter social ownership only with their own bodies and not lead their animals after them into sorrow. This fragment is part of the narrative that can be somehow named as ontological transformation of the world, where everything that is non-collectivized receives a signature of death. Some peasants, knowing their fate, oppose this reversed reality. They would do anything, even eat their own animals, and this is really true story, in order not to give them to the kolkhoz, rather than die as a result of this strange attachment to animals. Basically, in the foundation pit, the world of people and nature either dies, and the language does not distinguish between the human, the death of humans and non-humans, or is subjected to the newspeak ideology. Aesthetics collide here with propaganda in an awkward and uncanny way, uncovers how language can be contaminated because of the extensive exploitation of people and nature hidden behind the imposed newspeak. And the second example, also from the similar period, but a very different one, written by Russian poet Nikolai Zabolotsky, who also, like Platonov, was victimized during Stalin's era of terror, but he responded to the fading rural world in the early Soviet period in a more ironic way. So his long dialogic poem Agriculture Triumphant, and in other translations The Triumph of Agriculture, ambiguously portrayed the first stage of this Stalinist collectivization. It can be read as a satire or an ultimate utopian belief in the progress of technology. The title of the poem refers to the socialistic newspeak, which praises the development of agriculture as not only a branch of industry, but as a project of the new Soviet man and the scientific transformation of nature. Consequently, the narrative of transforming the village into a mechanized and modern chain of kolkhoz cities is strangely set in a wider cosmic context of transforming the lives of all living creatures. However, in contrast to Platonov's text, Agriculture Triumphant develops an idea to retell the achievements of collectivization as if animals were, next to the man, the beneficiaries of scientific revolution, involved in the industrializing the peasants and their animals' feudal world. The future is anticipated in this image of a super efficient milk cow, the embodiment of a machine that represents the accelerated progress of Soviet agriculture. There the air was fresh and sweet, and in the center of that place stood a fine cow, full of grace, its consciousness still incomplete. Goddess of milk, goddess of cheese, brushing the ceiling with her head, bashfully she raised her frieze and thrust her dogs into a keg. 10 streams descended with a crash, pounding the hammered metal vat, and the can, ready for dispatch, blared like a military band. And that ecstatic cow stood tight, her arms folded across her chest, game for anything that might ameliorate her consciousness. This visionary poem presents a utopian version of the triumph of agriculture over the old village, which will affect the human-animal relationship, and it is another example of contaminated language by the socialistic propaganda, especially in the case of how the term consciousness is used there. And the third example, I chose because I have really wonderful colleagues from Hungary. So, this is the example from the very late period of this, what I call, tired village by collectivization. And this is a reference to collectivization in Hungary, which was less intense in comparison to Soviet Russia and Ukraine, of course, especially under the Stalin regime. But it was still implemented, and huge industrial farming conglomerates appeared and competed with the small private land holders. They had their period of prosperity, but in the end, similarly to the collapse of the communist system, they did not survive the political crisis and transformation. This late communist village provides the setting for the novel Satan Tango, written by Laszlo Krasznahorkai in 1985. And it is coherent with Bellatar's adaptation made in 1994. But the film is a very particular example of slow cinema, and it lasts seven and a half hours. However, if you know the novel, and if you know this historical context of the atmosphere of the really, really tired community after collectivization in the late communism, it is, in a way, a very realistic film and very, I would say, adequate. The decadence of a collective farms community brings here in Satan Tango a contrastive narrative to the propagandist newspeak. Full of despair, strengthened by constant rain, mud, and strong, loud wind. And it is also used in the novel. The novel, in a way, is a very experimental type of prose written without paragraphs, and it encapsulates what can be named a tired village once again. So tired after decades of collectivization and non-successful transformation into industrial farming. Being morally and spatially perplexed, the vulnerable residents betray the very deep crisis and decline of the Soviet Union. However, it is not only people who have been affected by the Soviet economy, but also the landscape of the great Hungarian plain. It plays a role in the novel and in the film. So in this slide, you can see one of the characters that, for me, it's a paradigmatic character, the village's doctor, who is a special kind of observer. He spends most of his time behind the curtain of his window, peeping at people, sitting in his armchair, smoking and drinking Hungarian brandy palinka, and taking notes about the peasants' neighbors. His failing memory changes this seemingly senseless activity into a narrative, preserving the information collected by him against the decay that consumed everything around him in the face of the power that ruined houses, walls, trees and fields. The doctor's real-time observations are intertwined with fragments from geological history, and this is very originally indicated in the text in italics. They begin with the history of the Permian period, when the first mass extinction of species happened, and tectonic activity in the Mesozoic era in Central Europe, including the genesis of the Hungarian drainage basin. Although these fragments represent long-dure history which escapes the human imagination and precise data collection, and where human history is just a tiny point on the scale of natural history of the Earth, for the doctor, it is materially localized here, in this late communist village, when he tries to imagine the sea that covered this part of Europe. The most distant past is described as if happening in the present moment. It makes the doctor feel lost, and I promised Arniko that I will, you know, refer to the experience of being lost. So it makes the doctor feeling lost in geological but also prophetic history because of the captivating way the book is narrated. And here just one fragment. The history of the earth that had seemed so solid, so fixed under and around him, came alive, though the unknown author's awkward and polished style. The book being written now in the present and now in the past tense. This method of narrative, however, enables the author to render the bewildering experience that the actual place had a million years ago, being covered by the Permian Sea, which does not exist anymore. The giant scale of the tectonic and hydrologic changes was dramatic in its character, although it has left some remaining and visible traces. The doctor cannot resist imagining himself as the defenseless, helpless victim of the Earth's crust, among other non-humans, trying to escape from the catastrophic land transformations. And his imagination intensifies the illusion that even now, in some trans-geological experience, he hears howls of pain, incapable of distinguishing between the general noise and ancient prehistoric screams that were somehow preserved in time. And he remarks that the evidence of suffering does not disappear without trace. And now, all these sounds, all these traces were being raised by the rain. The real and present noises of whimpering, wailing, or stifled sobbing appear and disappear, like the houses and trees that were solidifying into blotches, to rise clear off or sink back into the monotonous hum of the rain. The landscape of sounds, the patchy surroundings within the reach of the senses, the Earth's history and time, they all swirl around in the capacious consciousness of the doctor, always a bit drunken, but sober enough to halt the chaotic and unpredictable events for a moment in order to write and deposit them in his notebook's memory. And for me, he is a type of historian in the way how he's lost in his historical imagination, rediscovered in the present moment, and expressed in a literary style. Satan Tango in general represents a tired Hungarian village that can be correlated with similar industrial enterprises in the Soviet bloc. Most of them resulted in the deep social alienation of their residents from reality, while different collective and family farm models functioned in different places in Eastern Europe. The literature of this period displays changes in the human-animal-environment relations representative of the rural culture in the whole of Soviet Eastern Europe, and is sometimes directly connected with the political stagnation, as in the case of Satan Tango. The collectivization of the village created an opportunity for writers to go beyond the even anthropocentric framework of literary and cultural expression and find the lost non-humans even in the period of high Stalinism and deep communism. When the boom of industrialization had contaminated the language, destroyed human agency and polluted culture. It is striking that even tiredness can be a great subject for the imagination.